Jesus Christ, by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ who are at Colossae. Grace to you and peace from God our Father. We give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which you have for all the saints. Because of the hope laid up for you in heaven, of which you previously heard in the word of truth, the gospel which has come to you, just as in all the world also it is constantly bearing fruit and increasing, even as it has been doing in you since the day you heard of it and understood the grace of God in truth. They didn't understand, but has anybody here understood? Just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow bondservant, who is a faithful servant of Christ on our behalf. And he also informed us of your love in the Spirit. For this reason also, since the day we heard of it, we have not ceased to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will and all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord. That word worthy there is the Greek word axios, and it means of equal weight. That you will walk in the weightiness, of equal weight of the Lord, to please him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power, according to his glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience, joyously giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. For he rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God. He's the firstborn, preeminent one of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. And no wonder God was so upset, the Lord, that even the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places, even the angels and the demonic powers that rebelled against him, they were all created for him.
Amen.
All of them. All of them. He is, verse 17, before all things. And in him all things hold together. He is also the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, or the source, or the originator, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself will come to have first place in everything. For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Through him, I say, whether things on earth or things in heaven. And although you were formerly alien, fleshly body through death in order to present you before him holy and blameless and beyond reproach. If indeed you continue in the faith, firmly established and steadfast, not moved away from the hope of the gospel that you have heard, which was proclaimed in all creation under heaven. That just simply means, it didn't mean that every single person's heard it, it just means that it just didn't go to the Jews, it also went to the Gentiles and all the peoples of the world. The gospel is available to them and has gone to them. Okay? Of which I, Paul, was made a minister. Now, I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake. In my flesh I do my share on behalf of his body, which is the church, in filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions. Of this church I was made a minister, according to the stewardship from God bestowed on me for your benefit, so that I might fully carry out the preaching of the word of God. That is the preaching which has been hidden, the mystery which has been hidden from the past ages and generations, but has now been manifested to his saints, to whom God willed to make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. So we proclaim him, admonishing every man and teaching every man with all wisdom, so that we may present every man complete in Christ. For this purpose also I labor, striving according to his working, to his power, which mightily works within me. Isn't that an awesome reading?
Yes.
Awesome reading from God's word. I want to talk to you just for a moment about the Father's plan.
Come on.
Anybody here in love with the Heavenly Father?
Amen.
He has an awesome plan.
Amen.
That he's been working. We read in Sunday school this morning from the Gospel of John, the 5th chapter, that God is working. Until now,
yes.
And I myself am working.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
God is working until now. I told you, I shared with you this morning in the Sunday school hour, that the Bible study hour, that God likes rest.
Yes.
God's all about rest.
Amen.
We all need some rest.
Amen.
And even though we may not have rest outwardly, thank God we can have the rest of God inside.
Amen.
In our hearts, through the midst of the storms, the rest of God. God likes rest. And at the end of the creation week, on the seventh day, after working every day to create everything, by the way, what a mighty God we serve, who can absolutely take nothing and speak it into existence and have everything.
Yeah.
Everything. Wow. And at the end of the sixth day, or the beginning of the seventh day, God decides to take a rest. And after creating man, he wanted man to rest with him. Wow. Can I tell you today, God still wants man to rest with him? God wants man to rest with him. And they were walking every day in the cool of the evening, in the garden of God, in the place of paradise. Man, it was just wonderful. Yes, they still had responsibility. Yes, they had relationship. Yes, they had, God had given them different things to do, but it was not by the sweat of the brow. It was not by something to where they would be without energy in their responsibility. But I got to tell you something. God, it was a time and a period of rest until man decided, deceived by the evil one. And man decides with his eyes wide open to go into a place of rebellion against God, against this God of rest. And decides not to believe God. Besides not getting, because they didn't believe God, led to disobedience. By the way, nobody, I'm telling you, even if a believer, nobody goes back into a place of disobedience against God unless they have a belief problem. Satan's not
necessarily wanting to get you to sin. He's wanting you to not trust God. And if he can get you and me not to trust God, then he will get you to a place of disobedience. Which then brings to a place, brings you under a curse and brings harm on your life when you step out of the will of God. Because the will of God is good. That means it brings benefit to those who walk in it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. It's good, it's well-pleasing, and it's acceptable unto God. Amen. It'll bring success to your life.
Yes.
Oh my, so man decides that in his rebellion against God that he's going to step out of the will of God because of his unbelief of what God had said. And I got to tell you today, there's a full court press on by the enemy to get you to a place not to believe God.
Come on, amen.
But I know we've talked about it before. Do we really believe God? Do you understand what kind of storms are coming in this world? I know you do. I'm not talking to the novices here. Most of you that are sitting here, you've studied, you've read, you're up on what's going on in the world, in the news, and you're informed. You don't have your head in the sand, and that's so refreshing to talk to people like that. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So what if the nation goes in, what they say, into a default this week? What if this and that happens? What if? Well, I got to tell you, it all depends on where your source is. What kind of rough days are ahead? We know. We all know this. We're beginning to walk into some rough days. God is with us.
Amen.
God is with us. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. And so since man got into this condition that he's in, God had to go back to work. God doesn't mind it, though, because the heart of the Father is to come rescue his people. That's the plan of God. It's so wonderful here that you see these things very, very much in the first chapter. Because I'm just going to count some highlights here out of some things we've read. Because verse 2, it talks about God our Father. And by the way, there's no grace to you and there's no peace unless you have it from God our Father. Blessed be his holy name. Who is he? Verse 3, he's the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We can stay and talk there a little while. And then we go on down. And we give thanks to the Father, verse 12. Why do we give thanks to him this morning? Because he has qualified us to share in the inheritance.
Amen.
Even Wayne Pennington.
Amen.
And if you knew what a rascal this man was. Even Leonard telling me some more stories yesterday about what. You volunteered it. We are rejoicing in our God today. We are happy in the Lord today. Why? Because he has qualified you and me to share in the inheritance. Oh, glory be to his holy name. And you know me, in the last 2 or 3 years, I haven't been able to quit talking about the inheritance. What a marvelous thing. And of course, if God owns it all, then what are we worried about? What are we worried about? It was wonderful because this week we've been in ministering to different people. Even God has been working in Laurie's life. Oh, it's phenomenal even this week. And finally coming to the place where she said, I'm learning not to worry.
Come on.
Yeah. Come on.
My soul. So we give thanks to the Father who's qualified us to share the inheritance of the saints. Verse 13, the Father has rescued us from the domain of the control and the powers of darkness.
Amen.
Aren't you glad to be free from that power today? serve a transcendent God. He's not just a God who's here and not just a God who's now. He's a God who's here and now, but he's there. He's the highest. He's above. He's beyond the universe. And I am not confined to this world. I'm not confined to interstellar space. I'm not confined. I'm in the third heaven. I have connected to eternity. Have you connected to eternity? See, we just don't need to present a God who's compassionate and loving and will meet their needs and feed them and clothe them all. We need to connect people to a God who is higher and highest and far out there, but yet here, a God who is eternity. We need to connect them to that kind of a God. A God who's bigger than humanity. A God who's bigger than themselves. Let's face it. All people everywhere around the world, including the United Nations and the UNICEF program and everything else, they can feed and clothe and give water and do all this stuff. And I'm not against that. But something the church can do. Yes, we can do that, but we can go far beyond that and connect people to a transcendent God. And give them eternity. Oh, do you understand, and this is probably for some future preacher too, that the church is the pillar and the support of the truth?
Amen.
I'm trying to hold back.
I'll go ahead.
And the truth has been lost. And it's been a wash out there. Why? Because the church has lost its way. The church has lost its direction. The church doesn't even know what it's about anymore. I'm just telling you. You have to hear last Sunday's message to get this connection. The church has lost its way. I will tell you this today. The Father has a wonderful plan. It's called God's agenda. And he wants to get you and me attached to and involved in his agenda. His work. What he's doing. And what you find here in the first chapter of the book of Colossians, you'll find in the illustrated life and the modeling through the life of the Apostle Paul, because he was engaged in God's agenda. He was fulfilling the plan of God, and it's revealed there in two ways. Number one, Paul was all about striving for the saints. Hello. He said there in verse 44, I'm rejoicing in my sufferings for your sake. Are you kidding me? I am rejoicing in my sufferings for your benefit, for your sakes. And he goes on down and he says there that of this church in verse 25, I was made a minister. And he said, this is according, verse 25, to the stewardship from God that was bestowed on me for your benefit. Can I tell you something? I just got to hear it one more time. It's been a while since I asked this question, but anybody here saved and qualified by the Father? Anybody here?
Yeah.
And as we said in 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7, 8, 9, 10, those are, then you too have a stewardship from God. You too have a stewardship, an appointment, a divine thing to do in the body of Christ for the saints. God wants you to strive for the saints.
Amen.
Saints. Hallelujah. That's what, and he said, man, part of my stewardship, of course, was to suffer for the church and fill up that which was lacking in Christ's afflictions. It was to preach fully the word of God and make sure that the saints understood about Christ being in them, the hope of glory. And he said, I'm going to teach every man. I'm going to proclaim Christ. I'm going to warn every man. And I'm going to teach every man with all wisdom so that I can be a part of bringing people to the completeness, the fullness, and the maturity in Jesus Christ. That just ain't the pastor's job. Matter of fact, no wonder churches are so weak, because all they got is one aspect of ministry from the pastor. They need about 10 or 20 other different aspects of ministry to them.
Amen.
The giftings and the workings and the ministries of the Holy Spirit and the Lord and stewardship that he's given you. Striving for the saints.
Come on.
Striving for the saints.
Amen.
Oh my soul, there's so much more to say here. Did I say this was going to be brief? That's why he says, for this purpose also I labor. I labor, it's toil. Striving. The Greek word there is actually the word agonizomai, which just means, you know, an agony. I'm agonizing over you people. Oh, my soul. Do we agonize over the saints?
Amen.
See? And the key here is it says according to his power, but the Greek word actually means according to his power in verse 29 is it's according to his working is what I looked it up in the Greek and I found it means operations, it means the activity, the working of God. This is according to the working of God. All I got to say is all of you that raised your hand and said you were qualified to be a part of the inheritance, God is working in your heart something.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
It's just like Jesus said, God is working until now and I am working too. Because we went on down in John chapter 5 and we saw that whatever he saw the Father doing, that's what he wanted to get himself engaged in. And as the Father, what he saw the Father doing, that's what I do. And a matter of fact, how he does it, I do it in like manner. So it's time that we get out of our carnal thinking and start getting on eyes and ears that are sensitive to the God is working inside of us. See what he's working. See what he's doing. See what he wants. This whole service today didn't go any way like I planned. That's what I say. Glory to God. But it's been a divine appointment. My soul. Why? You're just watching what God's doing, trying to pay attention, what the Spirit's leading in. What's happening? What do we do next? What do we don't do next? What do we go with? What do we do? When do they sing? When did this happen? Didn't even know Mary was going to be here playing the piano. It just goes on and on. How God blessed in the congregation music. Jesus, hold my hand! But that's why Jesus didn't go out and heal all those other people at the Pool of Bethesda, the House of Grace. He didn't heal them all that particular day. He healed one man. He didn't see the Father working in those other situations. He saw the Father working in one, as Obi said, certain man.
Yes.
Wow. And he slipped away. See, that's what verse 29 of Colossians 1, he says, I'm striving according to his working. I got to tell you, I could not get this message to come together for anything. And I usually like to come up here with it together.
Yeah.
Hello? Thought through. And I got certain things and it's got to meet criteria before I come up here and preach it. And I got to tell you, I finally went to bed at 11:30. Was gone. I've been gone every night this week except Monday. Every single night. And I gave away last night. And by 11:30 I went to bed. She goes, you're not done, are you? Yep. I said, it ain't gelling, it ain't coming together. And basically, I ain't worrying about it. Because I knew something God was going to give today. Look. Every single person here, God is working in you.
Amen.
The Father's working. For his God is working in you to will and to do of his good pleasure. And his good pleasure, his beneficial pleasure, it brings benefit. But that wasn't the only work he did. Paul not only strove for the saints, but the second and primary work he did, I'm going backwards here, the second primary work he did was sharing the gospel. That's what he did. And look at this. Not only do we have grace and peace from the Father, not only is he the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, not only do we give thanks to the Father who's qualified us to share the inheritance, but verse 13, we also see that the Father is the one who has rescued us from the domain of darkness. It's the Father who transported us and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. But it's in his Son, though, that we have this redemption. Praise the Lord. That redemption just simply means, again, to be rescued by ransom. Somebody had to pay a ransom to rescue you from the ownership of somebody else you were sold to. It's redemption. In whom? In his Son, that we have this redemption. And not only do we have that redemption, but we also have the remission or the cancellation of our sins.
Amen.
Is that exciting? Well, how many of them? All of them.
Wow.
Wayne had a long list.
Very long list.
fullness of God would dwell in him, in Christ. And then what did the Father do? And through him, to do what? To reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You know, there's a lot of things that the blood of Christ will do for you and me.
Amen.
And there is still power in the blood.
Amen.
But I tell you, one of the greatest things and the most prominent and the first thing that the blood of God, blood of Christ ever accomplished, and it's the Father who accomplished this, it made peace between him and me. And him and us. Hallelujah. Well, why did we need peace? Because the Bible says we were all alienated.
That's right.
The Bible says we were far away. Strangers. Isn't that amazing? God is a spirit and can be everywhere, and dead men walking around and have zero relationship with him. God might as well be 12 heavens away, as far as they're concerned. Because he made peace. He had to make peace because we were alienated. Why were we alienated? Because we were hostile in mind.
Come on.
Because according to Romans chapter 8, hostile in mind, that just simply means that we had a heart that was set on the flesh and not on the spirit. We had a heart and a mind set on the things of the flesh, and the mind of the flesh is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed could be.
Taking them back.
signs. Number one, he was laboring in what? Striving for the saints. How? According to the working of God. And number two, in primary though, he was sharing the gospel. That's what he was doing. And by the way, all Asia heard. Well, and how did these people, he didn't win these people to Christ. Well, how does it happen? He didn't win anybody from Colossae to Christ. Matter of fact, he never went to Colossae. I know of. So what happened? Well, he led Epaphras to Christ. What did Epaphras do? He went and led them to Christ. What a novel idea. All I'm saying as we go through life, we all have responsibilities, we have jobs, or careers, or we have many things to do and take care of. But as you go, God is waiting for his people to get off their own agendas and to get on to his plan,
yes.
Get on to his agenda,
yes.
Team up with him to accomplish two things, share the gospel, strive for the saints. Strive for the saints, share the gospel. And you know what? It's all as a result of his working in us. By the way, I can't do your jobs. I can't do what God's working in you. You can't do what God's working in me.
Amen.
I got my role, you got your role. Let's put them together. Dynamite! Move over, Jimmy Walker. Share some wonderful community together. May do it a little.